Hi, everybody. We are so excited to be talking to all of you today. I am with Robbie Brenner, who is the head of Mattel Films, which is probably one of the most exciting parts of our business today, but one of also our strategic pillars, which is about unlocking the value of our brands through storytelling. And we could not be more fortunate or lucky, really, I believe, to have Robbie as part of the Mattel family and as part of the Mattel team, creating this amazing next chapter for the company. But rather than me tell you a little bit more about Robbie, it is always exciting to hear Robbie talk about her career. So Robbie, tell us about how you started in this field and a little bit more about your career.
So I grew up in New York City, like yourself, and I went to NYU film school. And when I was at NYU, I interned at Miramax. And then I moved out to California. I was like, you can't do the movie business in
yeah,
New York.
Of course.
So I moved out to California in 1993, turning 1994. And funny story, because I grew up, you know, as I said, in New York my entire life. I had never been in an earthquake before. So I just moved into this apartment, and the floor was shaking, and I was like lighting sage sticks, like trying to get out, excise the spirits, and telling my mom that I was feeling the energy very strongly, and that my apartment was shaking. Well, a day later, the huge North Ridge earthquake happened, 6.6, and it was MLK Day. So luckily, many people weren't at work, but it was pretty scary.
Welcome to LA.
It almost sent me back to New York, but I couldn't keep away from the movies. So
okay.
I worked at Miramax for 9 years, and in the heyday of Pulp Fiction and Reservoir Dogs and English Patient and The
awesome
Piano
movies.
And just incredible filmmakers, really inspiring, just incredible, incredible storytelling. And then I went and worked at 20th Century Fox. So that lasted a couple of years. And then from then on, I went and produced independent movies like Dallas Buyers Club. And
I mean, stop. Phenomenal movie.
Thank you.
Literally a pop culture phenomenon that has lasted, you know, so long. So that's incredible.
It was a journey. It was a 20-year journey, but I got it done. So I got it done, and it was. I'm very, very proud of the movie. And so after that, I went and I worked at another company and ran Relativity Media.
Sure.
And made many, many movies, like all the Nicholas Sparks movies and Immortals. And,
cool.
I acquired many movies like Catfish and Don John. And
incredible.
It was an incredible experience. And then I went off and produced more movies. And then I found myself, with this amazing opportunity at Mattel.
Right.
Which is like a culmination of everything that I've done, going to work at a company that has such beloved IP, you know, in a world where IP is king and it's all about, you know, pre-awareness, with being able to cut through anything with video games, with social media, with television, with gaming, with everything. It's, you know, you have to have something that's really, really resonates with people. And so to start off already at a company that has just this incredible, you know, all of these brands that everybody knows, it just made my life so much easier and so much fun, because the talent that we've been able to approach that has been so enthusiastic about wanting to align with Mattel and wanting to work on all of these brands has just been incredible. I mean, just to name a few.
Name a few.
Barbie with Margot Robbie and Greta Gerwig. So that will be
incredible talent.
Yes, incredible talent. We're doing Major Matt Mason with Akiva Goldsman and Tom Hanks. And actually, Michael Chabon wrote the short story that Akiva adapted, which is so fantastic.
But you know what's crazy about that also is that I think most people don't even know who Major Matt Mason is.
No,
and
they
that
don't.
It's a brand at Mattel. But the impact that it had on Tom's life as a boy translated years later into this moment that you've created to create a movie about Major Matt Mason with Tom Hanks is extraordinary.
It is. It's really incredible. And we're doing Rock'em Sock'em Robots with Vin Diesel. We're doing two genre movies. We're doing 8-Ball with Michael Chaves, who just did the last Conjuring movie. We're developing Jack in the Box as a genre movie. As I was saying, we're doing Polly Pocket with Lena Dunham and Lily Collins. I mean, and the list just goes on and on and on.
So how do you find, when you basically think about the brand that you're working on and how to orchestrate the creatives that go with that brand? I mean, when you just listed 10 brands with such powerful names that are incredibly passionate about working on these brands, how do you think about finding the right people? Like, what's the creative process that you go through for each one of these brands at Mattel to find the right people to connect to?
Well, everyone is a little different. I mean, I think it's, you know, some of them it just comes to you instantaneously.
Sure.
You're like, this is the right person,
yeah,
and they need to tell this story. Other people approach you and say, hey, by the way, I love this brand. And you're like, really? I've never even heard of it. It's, you know, but there are so many hundreds of brands here, half the things I had never heard of either. And then, you know, on other movies, you're like, okay, what would be the best version of this movie? How should we tell this story? How can we tell the story in like the most inspired, forward-thinking way that feels universal,
yeah,
that feels like it could kind of cut through the noise of everything that's going on and sort of like make a difference in a way that's, you know, that speaks to people or speaks to the largest audience. And in doing that, you go, okay, well, who are the interesting voices? Who are the people that are really kind of cutting through or that are really, you know, unique and interesting and authentic? And I think it's all about that. I think, you know, making great art is finding those great singular voices.
And do you think that there, and I think it's interesting as most of the audience are inventors and creators in the toy space, but I think the creative process is similar,
yes,
in many ways, but you must find when you're working with these creatives and artists that there may not be the breakthrough on the first version or the second script, but how do you keep people of that, you know, artistry continuing to find that breakthrough in the creative process, knowing that, you know, there may be iterations that take place, but the single big idea is the idea that you're trying to drive.
Sometimes, you know, you take 10 bites at the apple and you develop a script and you're like, oh, we kind of missed it there, but there's a kernel of an idea. And then you
right,
kind of build on that and you sort of take it in this direction. And it's like, and sometimes you go all the way over here just to come back to here, you know? So
yeah,
it's very interesting. A lot of the times we'll get a lot of writers together and we'll do writers' rooms, which is really fascinating. I don't
mm-hmm.
know if they, you know, have some sort of toy collective where they get lots of inventors in the same room and they talk about
yeah,
sort of creating a you know, creating a toy together, and then one person is sort of the lead. But we do that in movies too, where we'll have 10 great writers in a room and we just kick around ideas and sort of say, what could this movie be? What is the best way to unlock this movie? And it's really fascinating what you kind of walk away with. Sometimes,
yeah,
you know, most of the time you do have sort of like a real consensus as to like what that story should be.
Yeah. And I would imagine that, you know, different thinking can inspire different thoughts along the way. You know, you could probably build upon it or edit it out. Like, you know, that's not the right idea, but somebody who has a good idea can be built upon.
Yes.
What do you, like, as Robbie Brenner, find as your source of inspiration? I mean, because you're working with so many artists and so many, you know, well-known creatives that have their own opinion, but you've got to kind of orchestrate the story to come out the way you want it to. Where do you find inspiration? Like, how do you ground yourself in that? What inspires me?
God, well, I think I take a lot of inspiration from my children, really, actually. I mean, you know, I think that they teach me sort of like the greatest lessons, and they say sort of like, you get what you need, you know, in
mm-hmm.
life. And so I think that's sort of my greatest inspiration, and also just wanting to create stories that I feel like, you know, that I can show them that you can tell great stories, that you can make an impact on things and on the world and in your own
yeah.
in your own way, you know. And
sure.
so I think that's what kind of excites me. And also, yeah, just in telling these stories, by knowing that you know, what you're making and what you're telling can make an impact, and it can, you know, evoke change, and I think that's really powerful.
Well, the examples in some of the movies that you've worked on are so meaningful in the narrative, and the impact in society is real. So it's inspirational to hear, but it also it translates really well into Mattel's overall purposeful play narrative and how our brands have missions and visions that really, we believe, add incredible value in child development, unlocking imaginations, and so many of the people that you work with that are affiliated now with these brands through movie making grew up with our toys and are inspired by what that value in the play experience was. So I think it kind of it blends well in terms of like your connection with your kids and the purposeful movies you've made, and now being here at Mattel creating this next chapter for us has got to be just so energetic and exciting.
It's really, really exciting, and it is. It's not just making, you know, movies to sell these toys. It's actually finding a way to tell these stories that are, you know, interesting and that are provocative and that do have something to say. I mean, you know, I love what you're doing with American Girl, you know, and what the brand is doing. Just it is so complicated having two girls living in this world today, what it means to be an American girl with the pandemic, with social media, with bullying, with living life on Zoom, with George Floyd, with just racism and just kind of where we are in the world today. And I love the way that American Girl has embraced that narrative to make it, you know, to make it understandable for girls growing up and not, you know, with the books and with the stories. I mean, I think it's really just incredible.
Yeah, that's good. It is. It is incredible. And there's a lot of really good work happening across our brands that we believe have real impact in people's lives. And ultimately, many of these brands are 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years old. So keeping them relevant is, of course, what we try and do every day. And you are such an important part of that next chapter of Mattel's relevant story as we create true theatrical moments that tell the stories of these brands in ways that people have never seen.
Well, I feel like this is a playground for me every day. Well, I haven't been here since COVID, but I do feel like this is my playground that I get to take all of these different pieces and I get to create and I get to sort of be, as you said, sort of the conductor of these narratives, which is so fascinating because you could go so many different ways, you know, but when you see great movies like Ratatouille or like Coco or Into the Spider-Verse or even Lady Bird or just different movies that speak to me, you know, that resonate with you. You go, you dream of telling great stories and making movies like that. And I do feel like there is such incredible, interesting, you know, brands and IP here that is sort of our narrative is telling really interesting stories, you know, through these brands.
So as an innovator, as a storyteller, we have many innovators out there watching us. What would be the one piece of advice that you would give them in the context of their takeaway as a conversation with Robbie Brenner?
To trust yourself. To trust yourself, to really look within and to lean into that, into what speaks to you. And I think that that's always, it's always like the first answer is the right answer. You know, it's when you start questioning yourself or we start like asking other people, like, is that right? Does that look good?
Does that feel looking like for the validation?
Right. It's like, no, don't do that. Like, trust yourself, like walk with, you know, walk with strength, stand on your two feet, be sure of yourself. And in that confidence comes kind of greatness, you know, and believing that you are enough, that you have enough, that your unique voice like can yield something great and do something great.
Strength of your conviction, right?
Yes.
The confidence that you have. And you have so much of it. I think one of the things that I've learned about Robbie working with her is you know what she likes and you know what she doesn't like. And the strength of that and the trust that we have in you based on your conviction and confidence is what I know is going to be, you know, the results of many great movies to come. But a great piece of advice, trust yourself, have the strength of your confidence and conviction, and particularly to an inventor community that we love, cherish, and work so well with. Stick to your guns and ultimately, you know, drive those ideas through. And I think that's a great takeaway for you and for me and for everybody watching today. So thank you, Robbie, for spending time with us.
Of course. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. This was really fun.